Welcome to our online experience. I'm so glad that you tuned in. And before we start, could you just do us a bit of a favor? Like this, share it, start watch parties, do whatever you can to get the message and these experiences into the hands of other people. We've got so many testimonies of lives being transformed and changed because of these online experiences, and you can help us make a difference. So join us for praise and worship today, and also sit back and enjoy the Word of God, and we'll see you after this experience.
we stand up, Father? We're about to praise our God. Amen. I don't need another reason. I just think about my Jesus. I don't need to hide myself up. I just think about your love, your love, your love. I just think about your love, your love, your love. I just think about your love. And I don't need another reason why I will lift my voice and shout out your praises. You are the greatest. Oh, shout out your praises, you are the greatest.
Yeah.
Oh, shout out your praises, you are the greatest.
Come on.
I'm not waiting for a feeling. I just praise cause I believe it. This is more than just emotions. It's the power of your love, your love, your love. It's the power of your love, your love, your love. It's the power of your love.
Come on!
And I don't need another reason why I will live. Lift my voice and shout out your praises. You are the greatest. Oh, shout out your praises. You are the greatest.
He's the greatest. Oh, amen.
Shout out your praises. You are the greatest.
Yeah.
In this place, and
I
don't need another reason why I will lift my voice and shout out your praises. You are the greatest. Oh, shout out your praises. You are the greatest.
Hey! Give a shout of praise if you love that God. Hallelujah, Lord. Woo! Put your hands together.
Staring into your eyes makes my heart come alive. Suddenly brought to life when I met you. Reaching beyond the skies, running deep, stretching wide. Perfect love realized here with you.
His love is for real, amen.
His love is for real. You will never let go, never let go. Oh, it's more than just words, love beyond my control, out of control. Cause this is real love. This is real love, oh. This is real love, this is real love, oh. Oh, 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 oh.
Hey!
Oh, 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 you're pulling me closer and closer. Holding my heart to the very end. Jesus, I'm
found in your freedom. This is real love. This is real love. In your heart I found. I want you. I want you. You won't let me down. You got me. You got me. This love is for real. You will never let go. Never let go. Oh, it's more than just words. Love beyond my control. Out of control. You're pulling me closer and closer. Holding my heart to the very end. Jesus, I'm found in your freedom. This is real love. This is real love. Oh. You're pulling me closer and closer, holding my heart to the very end. Jesus, I'm found in your freedom. This is real love. This is real love. Can't sing it up. Staring into your eyes makes my heart come alive. Suddenly brought to life when I met you. One advance, we're gonna let go, ready? Tahiru at 24. This is real love. This is real love. Oh yeah. This is real love. This is real love. Oh. You're pulling me closer and closer, holding my heart to the very end. Jesus, I'm found in your freedom. This is real love. This is real love. This is real love. Come on, give a shout of praise to our God.
You to give someone a high five and tell them how amazing they are for the next 60 seconds. Awesome. If you're on our eFam, we want to just welcome you and honor you. I hope you're sending some high five emojis to somebody this morning. It's so good to be able to connect with you. Stay tuned. Maybe you can grab yourself a coffee or a juice or some snacks as we head into the rest of our experience today. Their home, their whare karakia. Can I get a holler in the house today? It's so good that you could join us. And we just want to let you know that life is never meant to be done alone. And we have these connect cards where we want you to fill in for those that have come for the first time. We love to do life together. And with that, church, I want you to take a look at this amazing video testimony from a person who attends one of our family groups here at Advance Church.
Maloni, my name is Veal, and I'm a father of three, soon to be husband of Lavina Murray. I'm part of J James's men's group, and he's pretty much helped me through my journey of faith in the last 6 months, and all the boys that are in there, the likes of Blake, Ruben, Luke, Dylan and so. And along this journey, it's also helped me, I guess, put myself forward and come up with a testimony before my baptism. I'll just read a bit of it. I was born and raised in Taupo, and I grew up in a Tokelauan, Kiwi, Catholic environment. For me growing up, I always thought my childhood was pretty good. I didn't see too much drug or alcohol abuse, domestic violence, or anything I'd consider today to be traumatic. However, I did grow up with a system. It was a system that was programmed into my parents as kids and young adults, and passed on down to me and my siblings. It was a system where whenever there were issues in the family, the only way to deal with them was to shut your mouth, brush it under their carpet, and don't look back. I had a lot of questions back then. The answers I always got was just to move on. My teenage years was pretty good. Played rugby, had heaps of mates. Life was pretty much on cloud nine. I was even in a relationship too. Up until the first few months of my relationship, I made the biggest mistake of my life. I forced my love into a decision she did not want to make. It was a decision that I made that was based on shame, judgment, and fear. Fearing what my consequences might have been and not realizing what her outcome was. Didn't know who to talk to or even know what to say, so I pretty much used that system I grew up with and life went on. I was becoming a man of failure, no heart, no purpose, no mana. So I sit here today and I ask myself, how did I get here and why? It all started 6 months ago when I walked into Advanced Church, and I also joined a family group and started doing life with other men. I walked in with all this burden, resentment, and all this pain and unforgiveness from my past choices that had been built up under that carpet. I hear a voice. I forgive you, let go, you are my son. You see, I've always believed in God. I knew he was real. I knew what Jesus did for us. But I never had a real understanding of his true powers. Now I understand. I understand that my whole life was unaligned with the Holy Spirit, so therefore I held no authority over my life. I understand that I will forever honor my parents, loved how I was raised, but God put me on this earth for so much more. So he deserves my love, my life, and as of today, I'll break this generational chain, let go of the system, and be the chain that God designed me to be. For my house, my kids and their kids, live life through Christ who will strengthen me. So here I am today, baptized under the blood of Jesus and just loving life, all thanks to Advanced Church and Men's Group. I'm breaking generational chains, I'm letting go of the system, and I'm becoming a better man for myself, for my kids, and for my future wife. If there's any advice I can give to you men out there, just put your shoulders down, walk into that house, and just feel the love, feel the mana, feel the support. And trust me, once you walk out after that first session, you'll want more, because you'll see yourself, you'll notice yourself, you'll feel yourself becoming better for yourself, for your wives, and for your kids.
How incredible is that testimony, and how powerful it is to come together and be a part of a family group. That's why we really encourage people, get to a family group. That's where discipleship happens. That's where you get to be real with one another. And I think that men's family group is called Real Men. And the last family group they had at our house, honestly, the laughter was roaring so hard and so loud. It was coming through my floorboards. And I didn't really want to know what they were laughing at. But what I loved is that they could just be men. They could just be real. And that's what God wants. He wants us connected with one another. He wants us to be real and do life together. Amen? So I'm going to share a scripture for our giving today. And I just want to let you know, here at Advanced Church, we don't hand out baskets, so there's no awkwardness, no having to dig into your pocket to put it into a bag as it passes by you. But here at Advanced Church, there'll be ways you can give. We have a giving station at the back, FPOS and envelopes that you can give. And we really believe that once you get a revelation of what it is to align your finances with heaven, with God's kingdom, when you go to release, it's so much more easier. And it's not because someone said so, it's because a revelation came from Him on how we are to align our finances with Him. But I want to share this scripture in Proverbs 11, 24 to 25 in the Passion Translation. It says this: generosity brings prosperity, but withholding from charity brings poverty. Those who live to bless others will have blessings heaped upon them, and the one who pours out his life to pour out blessings will be saturated with favor. There's something in this. When we give, and we give unto others, and when we align our finances and we bring our tithe into the storehouse, something happens in our world where prosperity and abundance overflows. It talks about here that when we withhold from charity, it brings poverty. It's the same thing when we withhold from God bringing our best and our first fruits. A poverty mentality sets in, because I know the thoughts that can be running through your head right now. I actually don't have enough to tithe. I actually don't have enough to give. But God's economy is not subject to this world's economy. Did you get that? God's economy is not subject to this world's economy. His economy lines with heaven and all the resources that are available to be poured out for you and for I. Those who live to bless others will have blessings heaped upon them. Not just a sprinkle, but an overflow, an abundance, an outpouring. And the one who pours out his life to pour out blessings will be saturated with favor. When I think of the word saturated, I think of a water fight. And I know the youth on Friday night had a crazy water fight after their, during youth. And when you get saturated by water, you're just like, you know, you're covered, you're drenched. And when I think about this scripture, when I give myself to God, when I give my finances to Him, when I pour out blessings to others, I am saturated in favor. I am not going to go without. God is not going to withhold from me. If anything, He's going to open up the floodgates of heaven, like it says in Malachi 3, and He's going to pour out a blessing that you cannot contain. I don't know about you, but I want to sit in that slipstream of favor and outpouring on my life. I want to sit in it so God can pour out. But it takes us trusting in Him. Amen? This is what being a giver is all about. The favor that will come is outstanding. Church, I want you to stand with me this morning as we continue to worship. I just want us to pray for our family lists. So if you could stand with me, I don't know if you can see this, but these are our family lists. And on the back of these family lists are names of people that we have been believing for to come to know Jesus, come into relationship with Him. People we're believing for restoration and wholeness with Him. And I want to share this with you. Just at the 9 o'clock, I was in the foyer and a lady says, Gemma, this is my auntie. I'm like, cool. She goes, my auntie wrote my name on the back of her card and she's just realized that I am here today. You need to get a bit more excited about it than that. An auntie wrote the name of a niece on the card that Auntie told me today, this is my niece and she is in church today. Right now, if you are believing for somebody to come to know Jesus, if you're believing for a miracle for someone in your world, I want you to stretch out your hand. I want you to pray with me in agreement and stand with me. Father God, we thank you for every name represented on these cards, every household, Lord Father. We declare and prophesy salvation over these people. We declare, Lord Father, that relationships with you, Lord Father, will be established. Every opportunity and every invitation will be answered. And we thank you, Father, that your word is yes and your word is amen. And we just thank you in your mighty name, Jesus, that people are coming back to you. In Jesus' mighty name, and everybody said, amen.
Hallelujah. Why don't we stand, continue to stand. We're about to step into worship today, church. If you feel comfortable, lift your hands and close your eyes. You know, when you lift your hands, it's a really, it's like, what am I trying to say? Yes, it's a declaration. Like, you are surrendering yourself to Him. Father, here we are to serve you, Jesus.
But love, yeah, and it is.
every voice.
But one love,
every voice in this place.
And it is your love. Kote menui, kote aroha. There is but one love. There is but one love. And it is your love. Kote your name be lifted up and glorified. Let the earth tremble at your name. Let your name be lifted up and glorified.
Come on, let's sing.
Glorify, glorify.
We can love God, but I tell you what, there's something more when you revere God. There's something more when you fear Him in such a way that you exalt Him, where everything about Him, you just wanna do all that you can for your Abba Daddy. You just wanna do the best that you can for Him. And you can love Him, but there's something more when you revere Him, when you're in awe of Him, when you're just like, I love you more than just a love, but I honor you. I honor you, Father. Why don't we just sing that one more time? Glorify.
Glorify. Glorify. Let your name be lifted up and glorify.
Glorify,
glorify,
glorify, We thank you for your presence today. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're here, that you're amongst us. We thank you for this time of just worship, of honor and reverence to you. We thank you, we thank you, we thank you. We give you glory, we give you honor. In Jesus' mighty name, amen, amen, amen. Come on, let's just praise him. Let's just praise him and honor him for this morning. So awesome. You may be seated, church. We're going to turn our heads to the screen right now for an amazing day that's coming up and planned in December. I'm a bit excited about it for many, many reasons. So I hope you get excited about it. But please turn your heads to the screen and watch this.
Hey, church. Look, I'm super excited to announce that on December the 13th, we have booked out the Great Lake Center for an 11 a.m. experience. Just one experience. We're asking all our locations from Tūrangi, Taupō, all our online campus, and all our eFam to come along to Taupō at the Great Lake Center, 11 a.m. on December the 13th. We are going to be doing a all-in Christmas of the Nations. What does that mean? Well, we're going to be celebrating the different Christmases through every nation. We got items, we got authentic foods, we got the Word of God, we got praise and worship, we got kids programs. We're going all out on December the 13th. So I'm putting a call out there to every single person. Invite somebody, get them along. Let's fill out the GLC hall as much as we possibly can. We're looking to have over 400 people gather together, celebrating the nations of the Christmas of the Nations together as one church from many locations with one heart. So book it in, come along, and to all those who belong to a nation, maybe talk to one of our team. Maybe you could do an item. Maybe you can rustle up some authentic food for our lunch afterwards. It's going to be an amazing day. We're looking forward to it. So let's get all suited up, ready for it, and let's go.
Fantastic. God's good, amen? House is full. It's good to have you all here. For those who don't know who I am, my name is James. That's all that matters. I'm going to bring in the Word of God this morning. I just want a massive shout out to all our e-famers that have made it. Well, I know there's a big contingent from Taihape that came along. Come on. From what I gather, I think we got e-fam here from Tito. Is that right? From Tito? Did I get that right? Fantastic. Hey, guys. Good to have you here. Let's catch up afterwards. I'd love to say, if I missed out anywhere else, anyone else that they've traveled far, one of our e-famers, or you just travel far, anyone else, just yell it out. It's all good. Tauranga. We got people from Tauranga. Yay. Come on. Come on. Winning. Well, it's good to have you here in the house of God this morning. We had a great time at 11, but let's have a better time at the 9, but let's have a better time at the 11. Come on, somebody. It's been a long time since I've actually played this thing, but I love it. Just like, man, those are the good feels, man. I remember those things that God used to do. So remember, it's amazing how an instrument can just remind you of the Holy Spirit sometimes too. And just some things, just like, oh, there, and it's almost like you're touching the very heart of God. And over the last couple of months or so, we've been doing a series called Greater Than. And it's been a really great series. And over the last 3 weeks, we've been talking about freedom. And without diving into any detail because it's still tender in many people's hearts and lives, but there are a lot of people that from this series have just opened up. One gentleman opened up after 26 years of holding the secret in this pain. Someone just laid after 2 years of holding some pain and just getting free from these things. People getting truly free. I mean, truly free. It's not just the world rolls up the church, put on a mask, look like you're free. I mean, truly free, deep in the innermost beings of your life. Just so free that even today after the 9 a.m., we had a man that grew up Buddhist. And I went to go get me a drink at the back after the experience, after forgetting that I told everyone I'd pray for them if they wanted to. And they were waiting at the door and they're like, "We're waiting for you." I'm like, "Oh, that's right, yeah. Okay, let me come out." And I'm starting to talk to them and they said, "Can you just pray for us? You know, it's around a visa and all that kind of stuff." And I said, "Yeah, yeah, cool." So we prayed for them. And I said, "Oh, man, we need to pray for something else." And I said, "We need to pray over the husband." And I said, "You've been sealed by the Holy Spirit, but you haven't been filled by the Holy Spirit." And I'm like, "God's about to move and touch on your life." So I just placed my hand on his heart. Didn't push him, for all those cynics out there. Because you're out there, you're already judging right now. "Oh, I wonder what this fella's going to be up to." Didn't, you can ask him himself. And I just placed my hand on his heart. I said, "Fill him, Holy Spirit. Let him know that he doesn't have to experience it just through his wife, but he can experience through you himself." And then that's all we prayed. And then I said, "What's going on?" And he says, "I'm shaking. What's going on in here?" And he starts crying. And here's this man that grew up as a Buddhist starting to be touched by Holy Spirit. You see, everybody under the sound of my voice that is given their hearts to Jesus, the Bible teaches us that you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit. But there's a big difference between being sealed and filled. And many Christians walk around sealed, but they miss out on being filled. And Holy Spirit doesn't just want to stop at you and put his mark of acceptance, mark of authority, mark of mana, like Vio was saying, a mark of authenticity, of the genuine you. He was more than just wanting to mark you. He wants to fill you so much that you don't just know that you are free. You feel you are free. You walk, you are free. You start walking around your life knowing, "I'm truly free indeed." If anyone wants to be free in this place, somebody shout amen. Looking back in hindsight over my childhood, I can recall a number of times when the Holy Spirit touched my life. Who can recall many times where Holy Spirit touched your life? You felt like his presence. Anyone? Anyone in this room? Come on. Hands up nice and high. And don't be ashamed. You can't be ashamed of the Holy Spirit. Come on. Touched by the Holy Spirit. But I never really knew. This is why it was hindsight. I didn't know it was the Holy Spirit until 20 years ago. I'm 35 now. So when I was 15 years old, this is when our church used to meet at Mount View Primary School. This is when the drums, finally, we had drums come. Now, this is when the Griffin family came to church and their marriage had reconciled. And I remember, because Brian was part of a band, they were part of the band, our church finally had some drums. And I remember going into the Mount View Primary School. And I remember Pastor David Montgomery, our pastor then, placed his hand on my head and started to pray for me to be filled with the Holy Spirit. And I remember just falling back. I hit the ground, and then all of a sudden I started crying, and a tear came down my right eye, and then all of a sudden my cheek started going real numb. And then another tear came out the left eye, and then the other side of my face came numb. And it was only moments later that my whole body just became numb after just crying and shedding tears and allowing the Holy Spirit to move on my life. Still to this point, I didn't know. Not to this point. At that time, I didn't know that it was the Holy Spirit, but I was experiencing something that wasn't scary. It felt good, but I just became fully paralyzed. But I knew God was touching my life. He was doing something in me. And then I told my mom afterwards, and I said, "What was that?" She goes, "You were filled and touched by the Holy Spirit." She goes, "Told me about this book, the book called, from Benny Hinn, called Good Morning, Holy Spirit." She said, "Read this book and you'll find a similar testimony." And then I found out that before Benny Hinn started his ministry, he was asked by his pastor to come and preach like a crowd like this, knowing very well he had a speech impediment and couldn't talk properly. So before he got up, he felt the Holy Spirit just touch his life. All of a sudden he cried, and then all of a sudden his whole body started to go numb, and then he felt paralyzed before getting up. And then it dissipated, and he knew that the Holy Spirit just touched my life. He just filled my life. Now I'm going to preach the word of God. He got up there and never had a speech impediment or any speech problems after that. And I realized as I was starting to read this book that I never had a relationship with the Holy Spirit. I knew about him. I knew he was part of the Trinity. I knew I could read about him, but I wanted to have a personal relationship with him, where I can feel Him in my bones, in my body, being activated. And when I read that piece of book, I knew then that God was going to use my life so powerfully, because it was one thing having a call of God on my life, and it's another thing being filled by the Spirit of God and outworking the call of God on your life. Oh, come on. You know what it is. Sometimes you walk around powerless. Sometimes you walk around like you don't have enough power. Sometimes you feel like, I just can't do this in life. Can I tell you, sometimes it's because the Holy Spirit hasn't been activated in your heart and in your life. You've stopped talking to Him as another person would. And so I talked to the Holy Spirit. I'm not crazy, by the way. I've been cleared by my psychologist. That's a joke. But I do see a psychologist. But having a personal relationship, a real one, not the weirdo ones. Like, I grew up in a church where the Holy Spirit corporately did weird things in people. Like weird things in people. People rolling around the ground. Some people like shaking like this. Do the Holy. I'm not mocking anyone, but there was some weird stuff that just went on, and it never frightened me. But the kind of church that I believe God's asking us to build is one where the Holy Spirit ain't weird, He's real. You know, to the point that when we took over this church, we used to have the really holy tongue fire speaking people in the second row. Don't look at the second row, that's not them. I'll just make sure they aren't in the room. And they used to just do this in there. Like it was like a nice quiet moment where the Holy Spirit was doing something, and then they'll do that. And I'm just like, man, I just invited my friend and they're sitting right next door to you. They're unchurched and you're scaring the living daylights out of them. And so I had to actually teach our people that I don't want to stop you from speaking in tongues, but I want you to know that we are reaching people that are far from God, that God's more concerned about their salvation than your speaking in tongues. And I said, so just tone it down and do it under your breath. And create an environment, because the Holy Spirit doesn't scare, He's gentle. He woos you. He loves you. He cares for you. He nourishes you. He speaks to you. He rebukes you. He disciplines you. But He cares for you. He wants the best for you. So the title of this message is Good Morning, Holy Spirit. Good morning, Holy Spirit. Good morning, Wairuatapu. Good morning. How are you? How are you doing? How are you doing? Ephesians chapter 1 verse 13 says this, and you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of salvation. When you believed, you were marked with Him with a seal. Everyone say, with a seal. They kind of sealed, you know, those old scrolls that they used to seal with the wax and put the king's signature mark on it to authenticate it. That's what the Holy Spirit's done on your life. When you gave your heart to Jesus Christ, He marked you. He marks you. You're part of the big family. You're marked with the Holy Spirit. You've been sealed with the promised Holy Spirit. But let's look at this in Ephesians chapter 5, four chapters later. The same author says this, do not get drunk on wine, which leads to debauchery. Instead, be filled. Everyone say filled. Filled with the Spirit. It didn't say fill yourself up with spirits. Okay, just in case you misscrew my message and you go away and you get all tipsy, you can find me in the club, you know, all that kind of stuff. Don't do any of that stuff, okay? All right, there's no permission. It says, instead, be filled with the Spirit. So at one point he's saying you've been marked through salvation with the Spirit, but now I need to lay hands so you can be filled with the Spirit. It's one thing being marked, it's another thing being filled. So everyone who has given your heart to Jesus in this room, all our EFAM, all our online crew, if you've given your heart to Jesus, you've been sealed already. Your salvation is a done deal. You've been sealed, but you still got time on this earth to be filled. No longer you have to walk with the sense of being entrapped by fear and security, by addictions. But you can give your heart to Jesus and rid yourself of all these things that have held you back so that you can be truly free. The Bible teaches us, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom and liberty. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom and liberty. So friends, it's one thing being sealed, it's another thing being filled. Look what it says here. All believers are sealed, but not all are filled. All believers are sealed with the Holy Spirit, but not all of them are filled. So right now, in this room, we may have people, you may feel like it, that I've been sealed by the Holy Spirit, but I haven't been filled with Him. Our brother that turned up, that grew up Buddhist, he was sealed by the Holy Spirit, but he only just got filled by the Holy Spirit this morning. He said to me, oh, I was falling back. I lost control of my body. So he put his leg back to stop him. And I said, did I push you? He goes, no, you didn't push me. What's going on? And he said, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit. Now you're filled with the Holy Spirit. Go and live your life free. In power. You know, probably one of the most vivid moments I had seen the Holy Spirit activated in my life was on this youth camp trip. Jordan, I think you remember that, bro. Our youth band was invited to go and play at this youth camp. And I remember we were driving over, and this is where I remember the Holy Spirit working in such a powerful way, like a massive powerful way, that I knew that Holy Spirit was more than just a buddy. He was powerful. The Bible teaches us that the same Spirit that rose Jesus from the dead lives inside of the believer. That's some powerful stuff. And anyway, we got invited, our youth band. And as we traveled over to Taumaranui, it was at this camp. And I remember at the midway point, the Holy Spirit said to me, I'm bigger than anything. I can do anything. There's nothing too hard for me. That's what He said to me. I'm just like, okay, that was weird. We got there, we set up, and we're about to do the praise and worship set, just like you experienced today. Ready? It's all pumping. It's ready. It's exciting. That kind of stuff. And we're there with a whole bunch of over 100 young people. And we're doing the praise song. And then during the praise song, all of a sudden, these young people, hey, without a word of a lie, they're standing on these chairs and they're starting to throw pieces of paper around. They're throwing balls around. They're all yelling. You couldn't even hear the song or the music or anything else. And there was this irreverence in this room, and then they're just mucking around. And I'm looking at the youth pastor, which was sitting, like Michaela's sitting right there, right at the front. He wasn't even standing. He wasn't even doing anything. And I'm looking at him while I'm playing the guitar, trying to worship lead. I'm like, he turns around, he looks at everybody, and he's like, and I had enough. I stopped it. Stopped the whole thing. Turned around and go, that's us. And I walk past the youth pastor who's looking at me going, what are you doing? And I walk past him and go, we're done. And then us and the crew, we went into our cabin, gathered the team around. And I said, there's something that God told me when we were on our way. The Holy Spirit said to me, there's nothing too hard for Him. There's nothing too big or small for Him. I said, tomorrow we're going to see God move. And then the next day, without a word of a lie, every one of those young people that were standing on those chairs, no reverence for God, no understanding of what was moving, were all flat on the ground. Every single one of them, flat on the ground, crying out to a God, because the Holy Spirit was bigger than anything else. Bigger than their attitude, bigger than their background, bigger than their past, bigger than their fear, bigger than their insecurity. And that's the word of God for you today. The Holy Spirit is bigger than all those things. It got even worse, but good at the same time. The guest speaker started manifesting. The guest speaker. You know, the guest speakers at camps and conferences are usually the really holy ones. They're the ones that walk in and they've been preparing their heart for the Lord. She starts manifesting. She's at the back and her daughter was getting moved by the Holy Spirit. Her daughter was shaking. Everyone else, by the way, was flat on the ground crying out to God. God was moving on their heart. And He needed to do it because God wanted to free the guest speaker. And the guest speaker's daughter was coming up to the front shaking, feeling the holy presence of God. And she wanted prayer. But her mum was holding her back because she was manifesting. No, don't go there. Don't go there. And I said, let her go. She came in, prayed for her. She was out. And I said, now you can come. Went over there and prayed over her heart and over her life. She was delivered from whatever was holding her back from experiencing the true freedom of God. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom and there is liberty. You know when you turned up to the right church is when you got free. You know you turned up to the right hahi is when there's a sense of freedom in the atmosphere. Too many churches, and I'm not going to spend too much time, but too many church services and churches are not hosting the presence of God, and we're wondering why the people are getting older in their body, they're getting older in their minds, they're getting stale in their walk with God, is because the Holy Spirit hasn't been welcomed in and allowed to take full control over what He wants to do in this place. If you believe that, somebody shout amen. One thing being sealed, it's another being filled. I'm going to give you four things that you can practice on the daily to help you in your relationship with the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit. But before we do that, I want to talk to you about three baptisms. Everyone say baptism. And baptism, the word baptism means this, immersion. To be fully immersed. And many of us think, and we're going to be baptizing people, that's why the baptism pool's out today. We got Moana all the way from Taihape that's getting there. Honey Bell from Tūrangi campus is getting. And our very own Rachel McKenna is going to be getting baptized as well. And when we think about baptism, we think about immersion. What we think about is the water baptism, which is going to happen today, and it is important. But there's two other baptisms that you need to know and understand that the Bible talks about. The first one is this, the baptism of salvation. You are baptized into salvation. The blood of Jesus Christ, you heard Vio in his testimony on the video. He said, under the blood. He was baptized under the blood of Jesus. There is a baptism of salvation that happens. When we give our hearts to Jesus, we are baptized into the body of Christ, the church, the family. You join other brothers and sisters, loving and serving God both individually and jointly. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 verse 13 says this, for we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body. You are baptized by salvation, by the Spirit of God, to come into one body, to be a unified, to have relationship with one another. You know, if any Christian tells you that they've given their hearts to Jesus, baptized, and spends the rest of their life isolated by themselves, they haven't really experienced God's nature. Because we were all born to have family. We were all born to be of one Spirit. Brother, sister, Jew, Gentile, slave or free. And we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Come on, somebody. That's a good drink. Let me just give you, before we carry on, let me give you an example of what it means to be sealed and to be filled. Red Bull gives you wings. Now, I'm a little bit hyped because I had a V drink for the last message. I'm going to drink this one too, and then I'm going to crash this afternoon really badly. So please don't judge me. I could have got a sugar, well, I did get a sugar-free, so don't judge me, but it's probably got Spartamine in it. Anyway, my wife always tells me about Spartamine, and it's not good for you. Anyway. But this is an authentic Red Bull can, and it's been sealed. Everyone say sealed. But what good is this Red Bull can if I don't unlock the seal and allow it to fill me? How? It's just useless. What about all you? You got that fine wine. You've been saving it up for a great occasion. You'll be dead and we'll drink it. It's true. When you're dead, I'll open that fine occasion wine just for you because it was a waste. Why spend that amount of money and have something sealed and never enjoying it? It's just like your Christianity. It's been sealed by the Holy Spirit. You're guaranteed salvation. You're going to go to heaven, but you're going to spend the next 40 years of your life never really being filled. And all you need to do is unlock that seal and allow that to open up so that you can enjoy getting wings. Who's with me? Come on, don't drink that. I want to let it. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26. So in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. Everyone say faith. For all of you were baptized into Christ, have clothed yourself with Christ. what he's saying is that you receive salvation by faith. You can't work for it. You can't earn it. In fact, you can't bypass what Jesus done and think you're going to go and jump in this pool and think this pool saves you. This pool and this water and the act of it does not save you. Christ saves you. This pool is only a representation of what Christ has already done for your life. So we are baptized into salvation. You become a child of God, into the family of Christ. Baptism of salvation. The second baptism is baptism by water, which we're going to do this afternoon. Baptism in water is a public declaration of a private commitment. When you go down, when they go down in the water, that is them dying with Christ as he died. And as they come up, coming up as a new Christ, as a new person with a new life, a fresh start. Yeah, come on, that's exciting. It's exciting for them because we've had our time, but can you imagine the symbolic anointing and the nature of what's going to happen is that they're literally saying to every single person in this room, I believe in God and I'm going to die with Christ and come out, all those old things of me, all the things that I'm going to kill, the sinful nature, all those things, they're dying with me, and when I come up, I'm coming up as a new person. Water baptism. Now, people have asked me, do we have to get baptized to be saved? Sorry, did I say that right? I did say that right. It's the Red Bull and the V. Like, woo, I'm starting to heat up now. Anyone pregnant? Because that's how I'm feeling right now with hot flushes. People have asked, do we need to get baptized? Do we have to get baptized to get saved? And my answer is this: no, you don't have to. But it is a public declaration of obedience to God and to everyone else, and saying, I'm taking this act, doing this act to symbolically tell everyone I believe in Jesus Christ, and I have demonstrating the new identity I have found in Him. Amen. Baptism by water. Acts chapter 2 verse 41. We know you need to do this. This needs to be a part of your life. Because in Acts chapter 2 verse 41, those who accepted his message, this was Peter, were baptized. So these three people that are getting baptized today, they accepted the message of Christ, of the gospel. And now they're saying, you know what? We're going to get baptized. And look at this. And about 3,000 people were added to that number that day. The third baptism is the baptism in the Holy Spirit. By the way, each of these experiences, each of these baptism experiences serves a different purpose. The baptism of salvation confirms that our sins have been forgiven and that our home is in heaven. A water baptism is a public declaration of our new identity as children of God, followers of Jesus. And baptism in the Holy Spirit provides us the spiritual power to minister to and serve others here on earth. 1 John chapter 5 verse 7 says this: for there are three that bear witness in heaven, the Father, the Word, which is Christ Jesus. We know that's Christ Jesus because in the book of John it says the Word became flesh, which was Jesus. So the Father, the Word, the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. This is the Trinity working. And let me prove it to you even more why we know that these three baptisms are important. In verse 8 it says, and there are three that bear witness on earth. Spirit, that's the Holy Spirit. Water, that's water baptism. And the blood, that is salvation. The blood of Jesus Christ that gives us salvation. And these three agree as one. So let me give you four things and what you can do in practice with in regards to building your relationship with the Holy Spirit. The first thing that you need to do that most of you have been doing over the last 3 weeks is remove all barriers. Remove all barriers. Where's my main man, Parata? Come up here, bro. Remove all barriers. You know, the Holy Spirit has been teaching me a whole bunch of stuff about my own life. By the way, God's not looking for perfection. Last week we taught that He's not looking for perfection. He's looking for transparency and honesty. That's what He's looking for. If he was looking for perfection, he found it in himself, in his son Jesus Christ. So the perfect lamb has already paid the price. You don't have to anymore. So stop being so hard on yourself. You've been trying to get perfect to come to God, when God says the perfect has already been paid for through his son. Just come to me. And so he's been teaching me this, and we were cracking up because we don't know what a dove sounds like. So I just made a pigeon noise. Brr, brr. And it's amazing because in the Bible, right, when the Trinity was seen all together, it was when Jesus got baptized in water. Heaven's open, Father speaks, Son being baptized, Holy Spirit comes down, and one version says like a dove, and it rested on his shoulder. One thing that the Lord has been teaching me is that I'm resting on your shoulder, and I like talking to you. I like helping you. I like counseling you. I like sharing with you. I like rebuking you, disciplining you for your own good. And so he sits on our shoulder like a dove. And he's trying to help you remove all the barriers. And you're wondering why you're walking around powerless. It could be that you're walking around with barriers in your life that you just haven't dealt with. And he's like a dove that sits on your shoulder and he says, "Hey, Bharata, like, I don't really like that movie that you're watching. Do you think you could change the channel? You know, some of those scenes aren't good for your soul. This ain't going to help you. All you need to do is just change the channel." And who knows? We're like, huh? And all you're really hearing is just brr, brr. No, change the channel. This isn't good for you. This ain't good for me. And when we continue to ignore and grieve the Holy Spirit, because the Bible talks about grieving him, what happens is that brr, 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 I'll go find somebody else to land on. I'll go find somebody else I can sit on. I'll go find somebody else that I can relate with, because right now what you're watching isn't going to help me, or is it going to help you? And he removes yourself. Now, you know, get this right. You're sealed with salvation. But when you're irreverent to him, when you're ignoring the Holy Spirit, you are powerless. Powerful, powerless. Powerful, powerless. Are you with me, church? So it's time to remove the barriers. He's not going to just jump off your shoulder because you turned up today because you had too many beersies last night and you got a bit tipsy. He's probably sitting on your shoulder right now, talking to you. He's talking about you. No one else knows that the Holy Spirit's talking to you. You know what you could do? Is that when he opens it up for prayer, while everyone out there is feeding their face and having coffee, go up to him and ask him for prayer. He'd love to pray for you. Pastor James has got an anointing that sets people free. That's all you need to do. Nobody needs to know. Just between you, me, and Pastor James. Okay? And then you could be right now, sitting where you are, and you're like, okay. You know, for all those who are driving around with your learner's license when you shouldn't be. You know, when I said it at the 9, I heard someone like, oops. Like, oh, it's not such a much of a big deal, James. Yeah, it kind of is. When the Bible tells us God's teaching us to obey the law of this land, and if we're not going to, we're just like, oh, I'm higher than the law. I'm tangata whenua. I wave a different flag. Now, I'm not trying to take the mickey out of that, but sometimes we take a high horse, and we were thinking that we're bigger than God's ways, when the Bible tells us that our ways are not his ways. That our thoughts are not his thoughts. His thoughts are different. The Holy Spirit is just whispering at you. Maybe you need to do it. Stay up here. Liam, stand up, Liam. Is Liam allowed to be out of there, or does he have to stay there? Come on, come here, Liam. Give him a big hand as he comes out. Come here, Liam. He's going pink in the face. He's single, by the way. You're going to have to be, his bar's pretty high. I'm impressed by this young man. One of our interns in the Life of Our Church, Some of you have already heard me talk about Liam in my messages, and I asked him last night, I said, can I use you as my message? And he goes, yeah. Just that moment where you decided to listen to the reverence of the Holy Spirit through your pastor and through other people that mentor you. And there was a moment where he had to make a decision, and it was around the car, it was around the license. And because he works at 2 a.m, when I kind of hit him up, I said, oh, you actually can't be driving around on your restricted. This is a while back at that time. And we were having a bit of a discussion. And I said to him, I said, I'm not telling you what to do. I'm just telling you what God's saying. And just treat this as a Holy Spirit moment. And I said, so whatever you decide to do, you decide to do. Anyway, the next day, I asked him, I said, hey, how was work? And he says, I walked. 1 a.m. Walked to work. And what made it even harder is that as he was getting closer to work, there were 2 mongrel mobs standing in the pathway of him having to walk to work. And in his head, he was like, if I go on the other side and ignore them, maybe I look dodgy and they'll come after me. But if I walk with some confidence through them, then they might be okay with me. And so, can you imagine this? Coming past this with all my red bandanas and everything. He walks past them. And then he's shaking a little bit. And they're just like, Jimbo, Jimbo, and he makes it work. But I use this as an example because many of us could have hit that at 1 a.m. In fact, there are a lot of people in this room that have been hiding it at 1 a.m. But he decided to revere the Holy Spirit. And we have seen. We love you so much. We're impressed by this young man. In fact, his internship presentation, every one of our interns had to present 3 things that they had learned and they enjoyed about the year. Do you know one of the things that he enjoyed about the year was rebuke? Too many people get offended at rebuke and don't turn back up to church, where God actually disciplines those in whom he... So he said the best thing that's happened to him this year was rebuke. And because he's embraced rebuke and the reverence of the Holy Spirit, his life is becoming more fruitful than he had ever thought. And it's not about him being better than him or you. It's about him being the best version of himself. Thanks, bro. So what barriers are sitting in your way that Holy Spirit, that he's trying to tell you, don't drive with your learner's license. Don't look at those things. Stop opening up your phone at 1 a.m. talking to boys that you shouldn't be talking to. Stop opening up that laptop at early hours of the night when your wife's asleep and you sneak off to the lounge room and you're watching things that you shouldn't be watching. Oh, stop doing all those things that are just holding you captive. That addictions that you have, they're suppressing all those feelings that the Holy Spirit wants to deal with. Come on, somebody. Why aren't you sharing with your husband or your wife about the unfaithfulness that you did 3 years ago? Because if you actually just dealt with it, I would be able to empower you. Because too many of us think if I tell something that's wrong that the Holy Spirit's going to leave me. What actually has happened is that the Holy Spirit had left you and he's waiting for you to actually own up so that he can fly back on and said, now I can be with you. Too many times we feel like dealing with our stuff is meaning that the Holy Spirit's going to leave us, but in fact it's going to draw him closer to you. You're going to get stronger. You're going to get more powerful. You're going to overcome all those things. I believe this wholeheartedly. If you do, somebody shout amen.
Thanks, bro.
So remove all the barriers. The first thing of the 4 things is remove all those barriers. Maybe somebody has to deal with sin in your life today and deal with it. You know, we got 2 people getting married in the next few weeks. 2 couples. And we did premarital. The last premarital session, we do this with every other couple. And the last session of premarital, we have to actually have to talk to them about abstaining from sex before they get married. Now, in context, these couples have only just given their hearts to Jesus, found out God's ways. They've already, you know, had a relationship. They've got kids, all that kind of thing. And they've been born again, renewed. And now they come to a point where we need to get married, which is awesome. But I knew that the session at premarital, I have to talk to these couples about it. Now, most people would say, oh, it's only 3 weeks. Just let them carry on doing what they want to do. Oh, really? Are we going to treat God with that kind of irreverence? The coolest thing is that these couples took it on board. One of the couples, it was funny, is they sent us a photo of their bed, and the bro was on half of the bed with a baby cot fence in between them. And he's smiling, going, "Hey, we're doing it." But in reality, it was just a funny phone. He actually moved into his kid's room. And when we were sharing all with him, I said, "This is more than just you saving yourself for 3 weeks before getting married. It's actually teaching your children how God intended it in the first place. So show them, model them. Remove the barriers in your life that are stopping the Holy Spirit from empowering you through your life." Come on, somebody. Acts chapter 2, verse 38, we almost finished. "Then Peter said to him, 'Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.'" Repent, deal with your stuff, be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, that's salvation, and then I'll give you my Spirit too. And you can have the Spirit of God on your life. The second thing that you need to do in practicing this relationship and being filled with the Holy Spirit is request the gift of the Holy Spirit. Request it. Look what the scriptures say. Luke chapter 11, verse 13. "So if you sinful people know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who..." That's all. Just ask. It's funny, like, all you sinful people are really good at giving gifts. So if sinful people are good at, how good is your heavenly Father? He doesn't give you duds. The Spirit of God ain't no dud. The Spirit of God is going to transform your life from the inside out. All the things that you felt powerless in, you're going to be powerful with. Oh, come on, somebody. And all you need to do is just ask Him. Like right now, you can ask Him. You can ask Him for the Holy Spirit. Wadu Watapu, come. Touch my heart. Touch my life. Move in me. Holy Spirit, I want to be free. Holy Spirit, I want to be, I want you to move in my life. Lord, Holy Spirit, I want you to fill my life. Fill me to the overflowing. Fill me overflowing that rather than spewing out all my baggage, I'm releasing more blessing after blessing. Go to God to get free. Fill yourself with the Holy Spirit. Allow Him to fill your life so that you can spread. You're blessed to be a blessing. The Holy Spirit is a gift that just keeps on giving. Just keeps on giving. Just keeps on giving. Just keeps on giving. He's moving in people's hearts right now, and some people don't even know that He's doing it. The third thing, all you need to do is request Him. Ask Him, "Holy Spirit, touch my life. Fill my life." The third thing that you want to do is receive the Holy Spirit by faith. Real simple. "Oh, but James, I didn't get a feeling. I didn't get those good feels. Oh, I didn't get the fellow who was like a Buddha. I didn't get that kind of feel like that. I wanted to fall over." Just receive Him by faith right now. I receive Your Holy Spirit by faith. By faith, I believe. Because you can't do it by works. You just got to believe by faith. Holy Spirit, touch my life. Fill my life. I have to do it every single Sunday. Every meeting that I have to go there, people need something from me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit. Fill me again today. Fill me, I need to give out. Fill me, I need to help pour into this person's life. Fill me again. Come on, God, you know I'm going through my own stuff, but fill me again, Holy Spirit. Fill me again, refresh me again, and I receive it by faith. And then I walk into the mission that God's got me by faith, knowing that the Spirit of God is with me. If you believe there, somebody say amen. And the last one, and we're going to finish here, is to relate to, it's supposed to be relate to Him daily. Relate to Him daily. Look what it says here. I love this part. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14. "May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship," everyone say fellowship, "the fellowship of the Holy Spirit." Some of you have heard this story before. Me and the Holy Spirit, we got pretty tight when I was studying up in Auckland. I used to walk to Burger King, buy two sets of meals. One for the Holy Spirit and one for me. Some of you are judging me already, thinking, "Hey, you just wanted a big fat feed." That is true, but I did share it with the Holy Spirit first. I'm not even lying. I used to sit down with my journal and my Bible at Burger King, put His meal in front of me, my meal here, and I would just talk and I would journal. I would talk and I would journal. People probably think I was crazy, but I didn't care because I was building a relationship with Him. I had left my mum, and I used to say to people, I used to worship the God of my mum, now I worship God for myself. And then I found, then I used to lean on the Holy Spirit of my mum, but now I got the Holy Spirit for myself. And because now I'm eating with them and communing with them, and then I'll just lean over to them. I said, are you finished with that, Holy Spirit? Yeah, I'm finished with it. Okay, I'll eat it for you. But we had relationship. We had fellowship. And I really want that for people, because when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, life is so much more different. You overcome things that you never thought you could overcome. You could deal with things that you never thought you could deal with. Yeah, the Holy Spirit comes with love, comes with joy, comes with peace, comes with kindness, comes with gentleness, comes with self-discipline. Come on, somebody. Who needs self-discipline in this place? Just me. And all the, who needs to be not a liar? Everyone needs self-control, and that's what the Spirit of God does. And He wants to empower you. And if you practice these four things, remove all the barriers, request the Holy Spirit, receive Him by faith, and relate to Him daily. Good morning, Holy Spirit. How are you doing? How are you doing? How's your day been? He wants to relate with you, friend. He wants to spend time with you. He wants to engage with you. You've been doing things that you shouldn't be doing. And you've been ignoring the Holy Spirit. And you're wondering why your life is not fruitful or why it's powerless. Remove the barriers, your pride, your sin that you've been up to no good. The things that you've been blatantly doing that you know you shouldn't be doing. That ignoring the Holy Spirit's promptings time and time and time again. The things that you're watching, the things that you're saying. Remove all of those, because God wants to fill your life with His Spirit so that you can have freedom and liberty, and that you can have power. I believe in this place, God wants to bring some power to some people today. The type of power that you could walk into a room full of 100 young people, and what you see with your natural eye is not what God sees in His spiritual eye. And then you see with spiritual eyes, you walk into their place, and even the guest speaker is being delivered. I don't say this to boast about me. I say this to boast about how big He is. I don't know how many, there's a spirit of murder that would be running around our neighborhood, just around the corner here. And I had dreams of it. And I saw in this dream there was a spirit of murder in our neighborhood. So what would happen? I woke up one morning, I had this dream, shotguns going off. I woke up this morning, I put on the robe, and I went and I prayed. And Gemma was like, what are you doing? And I said, there's a spirit of death in our neighborhood, and it's trying to come into our house. I'm going to go beat it up spiritually. So I walked into that lounge, and I start doing a haka that actually us men, our church haka, we're learning today. And it comes from scripture. I am the way, the truth, and the life, that no one comes to the Father except for me. And so I start doing this. I start declaring that in my home. And then this black silhouette demon comes into my house. And I just said to him, get out. We had a fight. I won. He left. When you carry the Spirit of God, there are things that you're going to encounter that are going to fall because you have authority and you have mana. But when we got barriers in our life, it inhibits Him from truly activating Himself in your life. And today, right now, you can deal with those things. You can be filled with the Holy Spirit right where you are. You can be touched by Him. He can fill you from the head to the toe. You can experience Him in feeling and body and mind and speech today, right now. So while every eye is closed all over this place, every head is bowed, I'm going to give you an opportunity this morning, this afternoon. First thing is to come into relationship with God, your Heavenly Father. And the second thing is be filled with the Holy Spirit. Man, I feel something good coming. Great expectation. But while every eye is closed, if we can honor this time, because God could be speaking to an individual right now, even if it's just one person, that matters to God. You matter to God. I'm going to give you an opportunity to come into relationship with the Heavenly Father. He sent His Son Jesus to die on the cross to pay the price for our sin. We're not good enough to pay for it, but His Son Jesus was. So He came in place of us as a sacrifice, died on the cross, rose again, so that you could have not a religion with God, but a relationship with your Heavenly Father. And friend, I want to give you that opportunity this morning, this afternoon, right now. I'm going to count to three, and I want you to lift your hand. All our e-fam is online too. You can put an emoji hand up. And I just want you to lift your hand and say, brother, would you include me in prayer? One, he is the one true God. There's no other God but him. Two, it takes two people to make this happen impossible. Christ did his job on the cross, and now it's your job to respond. Three, lift your hand nice and high. Nobody's looking around. Come on, I see that hand. See the hand, brother? I see that hand, sister. I see that hand, brother. I see that hand, brother. I see those hands, brother, sister. Come on, one, two, three. Nice and high, nice and high. This is the best decision. Oh, come on, Komatua. Awesome. Come on, come on. Everyone else is all over this place. Come on, don't let this. I see that hand. Come on. All the people, nice and high, nice and high. Nobody's looking other than me and one of my team, just nice and high, and saying, brother, would you include me in that prayer? This is the best decision that you could make in your whole entire life. Wow. You can put your hands down. While every eye is closed, I want all our church family, remember when you get baptized in salvation, they become part of the family. So as a family, we're going to stand with them and we're going to repeat after me this prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for baptizing me with your Son, Jesus. My sin nature is gone. I am a new being. I am a new person in Christ Jesus. The old is gone. The new has come. The debt of sin has been paid for in full. I receive it in Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, extend your love, your relationship to me today. I pray. And Holy Spirit, you have sealed me. Now I want you to fill me. Now everybody stand all over this place, lift a hand or two. We didn't get to do this at the 9, but we're going to do that this morning. Leave the lights off. Leave the lights. Come on, every hand, come on. Just allow the presence of God. If you're new here and you're thinking, this is a little bit weird for me, well, would you just for a moment, because every eye is going to be closed, just for a moment, lift your hands and just surrender out, just take away all control, take away all those things, and just let him go. Let him move in your life. And we're going to worship together. We're going to allow the Holy Spirit to move over you, over your life. If you've never been filled with the Holy Spirit, I want you to ask. Come on, let's go, Ash. Sing, Ash. Sing, Ash. Sing Glorify.
Hey church, well I hope you enjoyed that experience. But before we go, if you just received Jesus into your heart, started this relationship with your Heavenly Father, know that you were never meant to do this journey of faith alone. So all you need to do is click on that link, fill out the details so that we could journey with you on this spiritual journey of faith. Remember, life was never meant to be done alone, nor was the journey of faith. So we want to stay connected with you and help you in this life. And before we get to the end, I want to say this. On December the 13th, we're super excited. December the 13th, we are meeting here in Taupo. All the locations of Advanced Church, all our EFAM, absolutely anyone is invited to the Great Lake Centre here in Taupo. We have booked it up. We're doing one experience at 11 a.m. on December the 13th. We're asking all our locations to come, all our EFAM to come along, book the weekend away. We're going all out. We're doing an all-in nations Christmas. What does that mean? Well, we got so many nations in the life of our church, we decided to do Christmas a little bit different and celebrate all the nations, from items, food. Man, we're looking forward to it. The message of God, praise and worship together. One church from many locations with one heart. And so I'm asking, I'm encouraging you to come along, book it up, December the 13th. Come to Taupo, the Great Lake Centre, at 11 a.m. It's going to be absolutely amazing. So this is your invitation. We'll see you there.